ASAP Conversations. This is a series where we invite guests, invite people we work with, our partners, and basically go over, have conversations with them. The conversations are around the current pandemic, but how it is affecting communities that we work with, communities that are in the core of our work, especially in relation to the larger SRHR universe. And specifically, access to abortion, right? And so, therefore, we bring to you another episode of the ASAP Conversations. And we have with us today Rituparna Bora. And I will invite Rituparna to introduce herself and her work a bit.
Okay. Hi, Nandini. Thank you for inviting me. So as you have said, I am Rituparna Bora. I go by go by she, her, hers pronoun. I work with an organization called Nazaria Queer Feminist Resource Group. We have been working for the last 5 years. So our main focus has been working to build a queer perspective while working on issues of health, livelihood, education, and gender-based violence. And we work with queer women and trans persons across the spectrum. And so we do capacity building training in schools, colleges, and with different organizations. We run a helpline, we do case work, we do peer counseling work, we have a counseling unit where a mental health provider, professional provides mental health care services to LGBTQIA clients. We do work on mental health and stress management techniques quite a lot. And we work on domestic violence. Domestic violence not as in seen mostly by many people as violence in the marital homes, but violence by the natal family to queer women and trans persons. So yeah, these are mostly the kind of work that we do.
I know that the communities that you work with are deeply marginalized, and especially in a society like ours, which is like so deeply rooted in patriarchy and all of that. So my question to you is, what was the situation before? Like now, you mentioned you ran helplines and you run a lot of peer counseling and support groups and like that. But there was a need for that. So if you could just give us a picture of the situation before we came to this point where the pandemic hit us.
So the situation was not so different than now. We had to run the helpline and do casework because there were many cases coming up where the natal family violence was very evident and was threatening to queer women's and trans persons' lives. The mental health professional had to come in board because there were hardly any queer affirmative counselors who were doing queer affirmative counseling for LGBTIQ people free of cost or with less money. So with regard to health services for a queer woman or for a trans person, it was very difficult to access sexual and reproductive health care services. And sexual and reproductive health care services mostly caters to married heterosexual women. So for our kind of community, and we should not think that all queer women are not married. Some of the queer women are still in closet and are married, and some trans persons are also married and in closet. So for but these services were not available to all those people as well. And when it comes to abortion rights, I think abortion did hardly took into consideration all those aspects as well. So therefore we, and also in terms of organization's perspective, where we can, and that's why we conduct workshops to build a queer perspective, was is very binary. They mostly see things in within the binary of man and woman. Still we say violence against women and not gender-based violence. And gender-based violence work is mostly dedicated to cis women and young girls. So I think therefore we thought it is very important for us to do this kind of work. And therefore the situation was similar. Of course the rate has gone really high now due to pandemic.
I'm sure like the situation was bad for a lot of communities in the past, and now the COVID-19 is become making it like apparent to us, like it's just becoming more and more glaring that, you know, there are these gaps in society and in our systems. So a little bit about, you know, if you can help us explore a bit about how the pandemic has finally affected the communities, because they were already being denied, they were already being, you know, sort of not having given access to many of their rights and services.
In terms of health services, the kind of health services that are regarded as essential is mostly COVID related, right? So everything else takes a back seat. So what takes a back seat? For instance, if a trans person is undergoing transition, will the transition medicine be regarded as an essential service, health service or not? Will he be able to get those services or not is a big question. Because if you miss out on a few doses of those medicine, there'll be a reverse effect to your health as well. Secondly, in terms of HIV and AIDS, even HIV and AIDS, ART medicines are not regarded as essential services by the government at this point of time. And if you miss out on such services, many sex workers, many trans persons, women who are HIV positive will have a big risk to HIV and AIDS. In terms of thirdly, so as I have mentioned earlier, that many lesbian women are still married and have to sleep with men, or bisexual women would prefer to sleep with men. But now, because the parents are always within the household, the parents are there, the toxic masculine figure is always present in the house, then it becomes difficult to talk about these issues with anyone. So I'm giving you an example. Think about a queer woman who is married and is pregnant and wants an abortion. Will she be able to access or talk to or visit a support care center or not at this point of time? She will not be able to do that. And because she will not be able to do that, why? Because in our healthcare services, these issues are not really important for us. And think about a kind of mental toll that would take on that woman or on that trans person. What if a trans person who is undergoing transition, pre-operative trans person, a trans man, has been raped within the household? What if a queer woman is in, and we have heard so many cases of corrective rapes, what if a queer woman is being raped within the household? Will she be able to access those services or not? So these are some of the situations that have come up during the pandemic with regard to sexual and reproductive health rights. But even domestic violence is sexual and reproductive health rights issues. Mm-hmm. So we have had many calls from queer women and trans persons where they are talking about a spike in domestic violence cases in their home, where there's constant surveillance. There's constant surveillance of whom they are talking to, what movies they are watching. Now, it might sound very silly to you about what movies, how does it impact someone's health. It does impact someone's mental health, because for a long time we have only seen movies which are very heterosexual, and now with Netflix, which is very privileged, of course, like only a privileged class of people can watch Netflix or Amazon Prime, we accept that. But we have had calls where people have said that they have not been able to see queer movies or queer shows online or on TV because their parents are always present at home. So this has also taken a mental toll. Now, not being able to have sex with your partner, not being able to meet your partner, not being able to talk to your partners or lovers has also taken a lot of stress, mental stress on the on queer women and trans persons, because the biological family is the most violent institution when it comes to queer women and trans persons. So they seek support. So we seek support outside. When I say they, we seek support outside of our biological families. And when we go out, we feel mentally healthy or better. But when you are not able to do all of this because of the lockdown and the pandemic, then it has become very difficult for queer and trans persons to actually be mentally well off or feel better. So these are some of the cases. And also there is a lot of pressure on trans masculine persons. So we've been getting a lot of calls from trans masculine persons where the parents are forcing them to wear clothes which they do not want to wear, which are not gender affirming for them. So this is also a very difficult situation. Or in terms of queer women, the parents are trying to use conversion therapy, doing emotional blackmail or talking about marriages, talking about that, okay, agli baar to shaadi to karna hi hai. So when you are away from family for a certain period of time, then you have a little bit of, relaxation when this has become a very, very big issue with regard to health and mental health of queer and trans people-like persons.
Now with this kind of a displacement where your safe spaces have been taken away and you're pushed back at home with hostile family members, hostile presence, it is much more riskier for people, many people. So thank you for bringing that point up, because I think these are certain myths we sort of internalize, and I think it's time to question those notions, especially with the pandemic coming. And I think a follow-up question, is something that
I also want to add about many trans persons that we work with are also not highly educated. They have not completed their schools because of the kind of issues that they had to face in schools. So their livelihood is suffering. So for instance, their livelihood is suffering to a big extent. So there is food scarcity, which is causing a big issue in terms of health. So many sex workers who are trans also and cis also are not able to practice their livelihood or earn money through their livelihood. I think that has also been a big issue with regard to, and we have heard of a suicide case in Sangli recently where a sex worker committed suicide. So these are some of the things that have happened because of the pandemic within the marginalized community.
Absolutely. Yeah. Actually, I have 2-3 follow-up questions which I didn't plan, but just hearing you, I have those things in mind. I think you've already touched upon a bit about the economy, because a lot of the trans people, a lot of queer people are in the informal sector, unorganized sector. So, and that has been hit very badly, as you just mentioned. So one is, wondering what is it that the communities are doing, or if the government has any plans in mind, which we know probably that's not the case, but what could be done? Like it's a very dire situation out there. As you said about the suicide recently, I also read about a trans person's murder that happened in the NCR. So, basically the risks have gone up much higher. Because you're vulnerable, you're left alone, you're isolated, and whatever support mechanisms were there has been taken away. So my first question is around the economy. Like, what is it that we're thinking?
After the pandemic, we have to set up livelihood options for queer and trans persons, and not only in the informal sector. So what has happened in the formal sector is also that they are laying off people. They are asking people to leave, cutting off salaries. So now think of a lesbian woman, for instance. She does not have any family support. She stays alone. Her salary has been reduced to, there's a cut of 50% on her salary. How will she be able to take care of herself during this entire thing? So it is about informal sector also, and it's very easy to lay off a queer person. Not because they're queer, but the answer will not be that the thing will not be saying that, oh, you are queer, therefore we're laying you off. But they will give other bahanas as well.
They're saying you're not queer.
So it will be easier because they'll also look at dependence.
Right.
So agar aapke ghar mein ek wife hai aur do bacche hai, then you have more dependence. Then if you're a single woman who does not have a quote unquote heteronormative family, then that person is easier to that, then the company, for the company, it becomes easier to lay off that person than to lay off that person with quote unquote dependence. So I think that also is happening right now in this pandemic, and what is the solution is to have vocational training centers. After the like NGOs should do something about it. The government should do something about vocational training services. So what happened? The government actually did something about vocational training services for trans men, for trans masculine people. But apparently they needed some 12 pass people. So 12 pass. कैसे हो पाएगा जिस कम्युनिटी के साथ हम काम करते हैं कुछ लोगों के साथ दे मोस्टली दे आर नॉट 12 पास दे जस्ट कैन रीड ए के बी सी डी और जस्ट कैन डू 1+1 कैलकुलेशन सो इट बिकम्स सो डिफिकल्ट फॉर अस टू फाइंड 12 पास पीपल एंड द काइंड ऑफ जॉब्स वी विल बी गिविंग देम पेंटिंग जॉब्स है यू नो वी विल गिविंग देम लेबर जॉब्स वी हैव टू डू सर्टेन स्किल बिल्डिंग सेशंस वी हैव टू डू सर्टेन लाइक वी I feel like the AAP government now should take up skill building sessions, skill building trainings with queer and trans people, where you actually live a life with dignity be able to live a life with dignity and not go and be someone's domestic worker somewhere or jharu, you know, like jharu pocha.
Yeah,
something needs to be done because always it's been seen that people who are marginalized, chahe Dalit people or people from the marginalized religious background, you always tend to make them do all these manual labors, and the color jobs are only hold for people who are upper class or upper caste or are heterosexual cis people. So the trans persons or the working class queer people will be left out from this entire notion of labor with dignity, you know.
That's a very, I think, very valid points there. And I think also privatization and how that has hit communities and made vulnerable communities even more vulnerable. Yes. I think that very important takeaway from there. Coming back to the SRHR and sort of abortion rights access, one of the things I was just thinking in my mind that a lot of times we are being told now that use digital platforms, like in the online spaces are open for you. But I'm wondering how much of that is true for a lot of queer and trans people also, because obviously there is a barrier of education, there is a barrier of resources. Because in terms of, say, like UK, they have, agreed for telemedicine in terms of delivering abortion access. And, so they are pushing for that. So I'm just wondering, in India, what could be the communities that you work with? Is that a possibility? Is that something that we can even think about now or in the near future?
We started Zoom sessions every Saturday. knowing that only a certain class of people will be able to access it.
Hmm.
Why did we start it? We started it because we got a lot of distress calls from people saying that hum to nahi reh sakte hai aise. We can't live. We are in severe depression. We thought, let's have Zoom call sessions every Saturday. We'll talk nonsense. We'll talk everything from films to movies to songs and anything. Let's not talk politics. Let's talk whatever comes to our mind. This is what our aim was. And we've realized that people from even abroad are joining those calls. People from Chandigarh, people from Jharkhand, West Bengal, Chennai, Bihar, UP are joining these calls. So you know that there's a need for safe spaces. But can online space be the safe space? The problem is that many people in this call say that they have no privacy at home. See, for instance, if I have to talk about my work, so I'm flying, I'm going by train to a certain destination, and I meet people in train, right? So will you be able to share with that person what work do you do? We say sexual and reproductive health rights.
Yeah, these days
for us,
yeah,
anything. But prajanan swasth pe kaam karte hain hum. Prajanan swasth is also regarded as mother's care or something.
Mm-hmm.
So for us, we can't say anything about what we do.
Mm-hmm. That's true.
So think about sitting in your home. You are in a Zoom call with a bunch of lesbian, bisexual, queer and trans persons online, and your mother is wondering, or your father is wondering, or your brother is wondering what you are doing. Who are you speaking with? So there is no privacy at home. This is one of the issues also. Resources to aajkal sabke paas ek smartphone to hai hi. Mostly hai smartphone. We have been able to talk to our clients through the smartphone. So we run this sessions every Wednesday and Friday. We used to run this counseling sessions. Now the clients are saying, so we started taking online sessions for them. Now the clients are saying they have no privacy at home to share about their concerns.
Yeah.
तो हम क्या बात करेंगे? मतलब मैं अगर डोमेस्टिक वायलेंस के बारे में बात करती हूँ, इफ आई एम स्टेइंग विद माय पेरेंट्स, लकीली आई एम नॉट, बट आई कैन टॉक अबाउट लाइक, ओ यू नो दिस वुमन वाज बीटन अप बाय द हस्बैंड, लेट्स डू समथिंग, लेट्स डू अ केस वर्क, लेट्स डू दिस, लेट्स लेट आई एम टॉकिंग अबाउट लेस्बियन डिजायर्स इन फ्रंट ऑफ माय पेरेंट्स. विल दैट बी पॉसिबल इवन टू टॉक अबाउट सेक्स?
No.
Will that be able possible? So no, right?
No.
So there's no privacy at all. I think that is taking a toll on people's lives. And online platform is important now, right now, but it is not the be all and end all. We need offline, face to face support meetings. We need human touch. We need a hug. We need the whole idea of skin hunger. We need a touch. We need those glances.
When we talk about social or physical distancing, whichever terms you want to use, and this whole feeling can create so much isolation. But human beings were not meant that way. Human beings were meant to be with each other, have connections. We are a social animal at the end of the day. So like the bonobo monkeys. So it's just it's a very surreal time that we are somewhere either locked in but also locked out. Final question to you is, actually I'll break it into two parts. Like, what is it that you are doing to keep yourself going? Because I think it's also a way to sort of share some kind of motivational something that people will something that people have hopes for, like, to carry on. And the second, the final question is, what are the kind of learnings that we take away from the pre-COVID and the present period, so that the next world that we move towards post-COVID is not the same one that we left behind. It's a better, like, somehow it's just a more just world. So what are the questions to ask? What are the who should we hold accountable? And what are the changes that we should demand in our structures, in our systems, even in our individual interactions maybe, that that next world, the post-COVID world, is a better world. So just this.
Yeah. It's a difficult question. What do I do? I have three cats. So if, luckily, I'm with my three cats and my partner. So I have the human touch and the animal touch as well. I cook a lot. I love cooking and baking. So I do a lot of cooking, baking stuff. I'm making everything at home, and I'm making North Indian dishes, which is a big thing for me because I hardly cook North Indian, like chaat papri and bhalla papri, and I'm very excited about all those things. And I'm watching horrors and thrillers, lots of horror movies and thriller movies, because I love horror movies and thriller movies. I think that's what I'm doing. Reading, lot of reading, not lot of reading, but reading articles. And I'm also doing a course, like a small course. I'm busy with that as well. Plus, I'm working, a little bit working, and I'm always in touch with my friends. Video call once in a while, or talk every day with certain friends. So that's what I'm doing. I think my cats might be wondering why are these humans home all the time now that, because I used to travel a lot.
Yeah.
About the thing, I think for us as the Queer Feminist Resource Group, we've always requested organizations to stop talking in binaries. I think that is very important for us, and to not see as an add-on or as an etc. I think that is something which we really, really hope for organizations to consider. And so we are not add-ons, we are not etc. We are marginalized. The marginalization doesn't come because of us. The marginalization is happening because how the society is seeing us, or how the society is constructed. I think when we talk about healthcare services or violence or other issues, I think it is very, 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 very important to talk about the marginalized, not sitting there from the center, but to think about marginalization as an important aspect of learning from the margins, and not that you want to make the margins become the center, but you have to learn from the margins and to be able to learn how our family structures are, how queer persons' lives are, how queer persons' lived realities are, and to make that part of each other's work. I think that's how we make a better, just world.
Thank you so much. I think, again, so many things resonated there, like the cat and the people touch, partners, friends, all of that. I think whatever works for us, I think that's definitely a takeaway for audiences who have tuned in. Last answer that you gave, and how we should, as organizations, move beyond looking at binaries. I completely agree with you. I think we have to learn from the margins, and that's a great learning to reinforce again and again. So thank you so much for the contribution to today's conversations. And, you know, it was lovely
chatting
with you.
Thank you for having me. Yeah, it was lovely.